Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Yeah, I'm just trying to make a couple little short videos, which I always wanted to do, but I always keep going on and on. But I was going back, the Lord led me to go back through my notes, and there's some things I want to talk about. But in the meantime, I had some messages from the Lord had given me, and I thought I'd put them out, because I have some watchers of my videos who really love the deep stuff, and this is one of the deep things the Lord gave me. And this was from 2006, 3/15/2006. And, you know, the book of Revelation, first off, you know, the book of Revelation is the book of Revelation of Jesus Christ. It's the revealing of the Lord. So the book of Revelation is all about the revealing of the Lord, giving us the spiritual stuff, you know. The problem is lots of people, you know, they're only looking at the natural and the flesh, and they're thinking with the human mind, not by the Spirit of God. So the Bible says that it's spiritually discerned. So I just want to give you an example, and I pray that the Lord would use this to give you a hunger for the deeper things. You know, there's lots of people that get off into, you know, they take one verse and run with it, and that's where you end up with a cult, okay? And so, as I always quote on lots of my videos, the Bible says, our famous quote from the Moravians, who founded the place where I'm from there in Winston-Salem, for the Europeans. And anyway, they were the original Protestants and the first missionaries from the Protestant movement and around the world. And anyway, their motto is, in essentials, unity, in non-essentials, diversity, and in all things, love. And like I say, I've mentioned this several times, there's lots of people on YouTube who are not operating in love. And as the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, without love, I'm nothing. The biggest problem I observe is people is not, you know, in love. And then there's not operating in love, you know, when you talk about doctrines like the rapture or whatever, pre-trib rapture, mid-trib, post-trib, whatever, no rapture. It's a non-essential doctrine for salvation, no matter what people might think. There's nowhere in this, of course, I believe in the pre-trib rapture, but there's nowhere in the, you know, John 3:16 where it says, thou shalt believe in the rapture or go to hell. It doesn't say that. Or thou shalt, if you do believe in the rapture, you're going to go to hell. It doesn't say that. So, that's why, you know, the Lord led me to start my YouTube channel. I don't know what it is, but there's lots of people on the internet who are, you know, who are not ministers. They don't know the Word of God, and they're making videos and they're preaching. And then there's people who are preachers and they're on the internet doing the news. So I don't know what's going on, brothers and sisters. And I'll just add on to that. For anybody that watches my videos and likes my videos, or anybody else's, and I thank those who might defend me if someone attacks me on, you know, in the comments and you defend me. But remember, our job is not about defending people, but the Word of God. And so there, if you're an avid follower of someone on YouTube, you know, don't let them become an idol to you. And don't take their, you know, because you like them, no matter what they do, you just let it slide. And of course, I'm not saying to, you know, attack them or stop liking them. I'm saying that, you know, your defense should be for the Lord and for the, you know, to defend the hope that lies within you, the Bible says, to defend the gospel. And, you know, and stand up for the Word of God, not for man. So I just want to put that out there, because lots of times, you know, people on the YouTube and preachers all over the world, they become like a cult of personality. And that's, you know, there are, as a matter of fact, right here in the Philippines, there's a guy, Apollo C. Kibaloy, Pastor Apollo C. Kibaloy. You can look him up. He claims to be the appointed son of God, and he has over a million, he claims 3 million followers around the world, and lots, and maybe 10% are not Filipinos. They're, you know, foreigners from different countries. And anyway, you know, it starts out where the people are exalting the pastor above God. That's in the States, but I've observed that it's much worse here in the Philippines. There's several different denominations where the pastor is like a god. There's one that ran for president, you know, and then, you know, their denomination's all about him and not about the Lord. And so, just like with the Catholics, you know, kind of exalting the Pope and the saints and all that over, you know, the Lord. And so, lots of denominations do that. Let me just see. I said I was going to make a short video, but you know that teaching and that pastor spirit comes on me when I'm making the videos, even though I'm not really, don't want to be, and I don't believe the Lord has called me to be a pastor necessarily. But you know, we in the ministry, sometimes we work for a while as an evangelist, and the Lord might use us as a pastor or whatever, a missionary, whatever. You can go around to different offices as the Lord would lead you. So anyway, when in the book of Revelation of Jesus Christ in chapter 4, when John is called up to heaven, And we talk about the 24 elders. And then you see down there in verse 6, it says, and before the throne there was... Wait a minute. Oh, yeah. There were a sea of glass like in a crystal around the throne. On each side of the throne are four living creatures full of eyes in front and back. You know, I've been... Just the other day I made a video about the Sphinx, you know, and, you know, Satan or Lucifer before was one of the anointed cherubs that covers. So he was similar to one of these guys. But the Lord had given me something else about this I want to tell you about. At verse 7, the first living creature was like a lion. You go, like, the second one was like an ox. The third one was like the face of a man. And the fourth living creature was like the face of an eagle. And all, and it says they all had six wings, and they had full of eyes all around within. And day and night they never stopped saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And what I wanted to tell you about that was something that the Lord showed me about that. For one thing, this the book is the book of Revelation of Jesus Christ. It reveals things about the Lord. Okay, so those four living creatures represent four different things, and I want to compare it to the ministry. Okay, and what I had written in my notes in 2006 was that really that you can compare, and I don't know how deep I can get into this, but I'll just go through it quickly. Okay, the first living creature is like a lion. Okay, and that's in the authority of Christ. So, you know, there's the people talk about the fivefold ministry, which really is the fourfold, because pastor and teacher in the Greek, they say, really goes together, pastor, teacher. So you got the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor, teacher. Okay, so looking at this, you see the lion. Okay, Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah. So the Lord didn't give all of his authority to one man. Sometimes these people on TV are saying they're walking in the fivefold ministry. The Lord never gave all of his authority to one man. Even the original apostles, you know, they weren't in complete authority over the church. He didn't make any popes, okay? They had authority like Paul to the Gentiles, Peter to the Jewish people, like that. But they had authority in their area. But the apostles have the highest authority, the Bible says. First apostles, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, he set first apostles, then prophets, then evangelists, pastors, teachers. Okay, whatever. Okay, so the lion... Everyone in the ministry, you know, has an attribute of Christ and part of his authority. Okay, that's what I'm trying to say. So the lion there in verse 7 of Revelation 4 is really like an apostle comparing the anointing of Christ as a lion, his authority and supremacy. You know, the lion is the king of the jungle. Then you have the apostles as the king of the churches in as far as their power and authority as a human in the body of Christ in the church. You know, so you have apostles. Okay, and then someone a message on here, someone the other day when I mentioned about prophets and apostles, about people on TV trying to scam people out of money. We know that, okay? Those people are not really apostles and prophets, okay? There were apostles, and there can be apostles now. Apostle means a sent one. Like I said, really a missionary is doing part of the work of an apostle, you know, in the natural side of going to a place, and a new place where there are no churches, and establishing the body of Christ in a place where there is no body of Christ. That's part of the work of an apostle. Okay. Anyway, but me, of course, like I said, my anointing that I have from the Lord is in the prophetic. Okay, that's really the office that the Lord put me in, the primary office. And then, I work as an evangelist. We do the work of an evangelist, do the work of a pastor, do the work, you know, and like I said, as a missionary, you know, part of that is that what we would call the apostolic office. Okay, so the first living creature, the lion, represents as a revealing of Christ too. Is a lion of tribe of Judah, and then apostles operating in that office. The second living creature is like an ox. Okay, the ox represents the servant. Okay, so the servant spirit of Christ was the, you know, was came as the, you know, the suffering servant. Okay, and I'm going to connect the Gospels to here too. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Each one of those Gospels connects to here also. The four different sides of Christ as we would look at him as human. God revealed himself through, you know, Jesus is the, you know, the expressed image of the Father. Let's see, the Bible says. Okay, so like an ox, then you got a pastor. A pastor is a servant, right? He's a servant of the church. So minister, the Greek word for minister, means to serve. He's a servant. The third living creature is the face of a man. Okay, let's see if you can figure it out. Which office compares to that? I already mentioned pastor and apostle. What is it? Evangelist. Evangelist comes to people as they are. When an evangelist speaks, the world says, oh, God is like one of us. God is presenting himself as one of us, like the Gospel of Luke is also that. He is the Son of Man. Okay, he's presenting himself as one of us. Okay, and then the fourth living creature is an eagle. Okay, what is an eagle? An eagle flies high, right? An eagle sees from a high view. Eagle sees from God's eye view, a bird's eye view, God's eye view. So what would that be? A prophet. See how they connect? So the four gospels connect to that too. You got, like I already said, that Mark is the suffering servant. Matthew, I'm just saying him as I can think of. Matthew is the King of Kings. Jesus is the King of Kings. So that's a lion. Mark, suffering servant. You know, that's how the theologians say each gospel is written, to portray the Lord and reveal the Lord as a suffering servant. Okay, then Luke, he's one of us. He's the Son of Man. You know, it's written for the Gentiles. It's written that, oh, he's the Son of Man. He's one of us. He's a man who is also God. Then you got John. The Gospel of John is very mystical. It's different than the other Gospels, very mystical. It's a prophetic type of book, and it's much deeper, you know, where it's darkness and then light. You know, John uses very simple words. John is the most least amount of words used of any book in the New Testament, and John uses simple words like light and darkness and light and all that too. You know, to really have deeper meanings. The Gospel of John is simple words, but very, very deep meaning. And this is how the prophetic office works. That's how God speaks. In the spiritual side, in the deep things of God, or in this case, also like an eagle, the high view of things. Simple, but yet very deep words. Okay, so I wrote this down. I mentioned that it's the fourfold ministry, as I said, that really in the Greek, and it's really true that pastor and teacher go together. All right, so then this is something else I wrote down that the Lord gave me in connection with that. People see the lion or apostle and say, I did not know that God put such authority in his people and also in, you know, through Christ. And then people see the prophet eagle and say, I did not know that God let people fly so high. People see a man or an evangelist, you know, the face of the man of the four living creatures, and say, I did not know Jesus or an evangelist is like one of us. You know, that we're in the image of God. People see the pastor slash ox and say, I did not know that Christ or pastors were such servants to us. So our Lord was telling me that's what people's response should be, or, you know, his people's response when, you know, the Lord would reveal himself to them. And you're talking about the book of Revelation. I'm talking about personal, individual revelation of who is the Lord. So the Lord uses his people. And in this case, I'm talking about these different offices of pastor, prophet, evangelist, apostle, to reveal himself to people. And he divides his gifts. Now, see, that's the gifts of the Holy Spirit amongst us as he wills. But I'm talking about the offices, the four, you know, four or five offices of the ministry. And, you know, the thing is that on YouTube, look, I love home churches, and I think that's really a great way to go. And I just want to say this. You have to have a balance, okay? Not everyone is a pastor. And then I've been to home churches before, and then it's like they're anti-authority of the church so much that it becomes rebellion against the Lord. And then again, of course, you got on the opposite extreme, you got Catholicism. And you got, you know, these denominations, and then even amongst Pentecostals and all that, as I mentioned, the pastor becomes like a god, like the Pope. I know a preacher here in the Philippines, up there in Luzon, who they even call, his nickname is the Pope. And it turns out also that he's also a homosexual. But, you know, so I won't say anything more about him. That's the kind of things that you deal with. You know, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, and that's what happens. You know, with the Pope and with these people like this pastor I just mentioned and all that. You know, the authority overwhelms them because it wasn't, you know, it's beyond their limit and their ability to handle it. You know, it becomes prideful, and that's why we have to be very careful. But on the other extreme, we can't. You know, there's people that. Who are, especially on YouTube, you know, there's lots of people, independent-minded people, and I'm all for that. Separate ourselves from all of, you know, we're in the middle of the great falling away, you know, in the church, and that's another video I need to make. The Lord just gave me a word about that. Make another video. But you have to be careful that, you know, God does have true pastors out there, and true evangelists, and true apostles, and true prophets. So save your comments about all the fakes on TV. Like I said, I already know about them. I agree with you. You know, if they'd let me on there, they wouldn't let me on. They'd be ready to stone me or some other people on YouTube, too, if we get on there, okay? Because we're not trying to, you know, sell our books and stuff. And there's other people, you know, they have their own agenda, and then, hey, they're going to go along to get along and compromise because of whatever it may be, because they crave attention or because of money or whatever it may be. It would motivate them to compromise, you know, or women, or if we're in the case of a man, you know, maybe it's, you know, as they use the ministry to access women or whatever. You know, there's lots of, you know, power corrupts, and that's why we have to be humble. We have to humble ourselves, you know, myself too, and any of you guys. We have to humble ourselves daily, and that's what I say. Even though I know that Billy Graham is a 33rd degree Mason, and I know all those things about Billy Graham, okay? But as far as all the authority that he's had and all of the presidents he golfed with and all that, he's still a humble man. And that's why a lot of people respect Billy Graham, for the fact that he is a very humble man despite all the notoriety that he's had. He's, you know, one of the most famous people in the world. But yet, he's a humble guy. So I will say that about him, that he was not corrupted by, you know, by power and money and all those things. It never went to his head, which almost 100% of people it does. You know, and I just pray that for any of you guys or whatever, that, you know, or myself included, you know, notoriety may be growing on YouTube. Not as like some, but it's growing. And I pray always that, hey, that the Lord would always keep me humble, and that I wouldn't say, oh, you know, 1,000 people watch my video, big deal. You know, that we have to humble ourselves. It doesn't make me right. And no matter what, you know, we're all still a man or a woman. We're still a human. And, you know, by the grace of God, you know, the Bible says, you know, when you're talking about a sinner, you know, but by the grace of God go I. You know, if it wasn't for the grace of God, I would also be on my way to hell. So we always need to humble ourselves. Okay, brothers and sisters, I've already been talking for a long time. I'll cut this off because I've got more videos to make.